Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, DwyerVIP.com. You know, I heard about Dan Goosen's illness right before he passed, and it hit me hard. Let me give a little context. Let's go back to a different time. Let me just say one of the things about getting older is you actually start to remember a world that no longer exists. And you also remember when people today who are in prominent places were different people back then, maybe outside mainstream society. So let's go back to the early 1990s in Los Angeles. I had gotten out of school. I was running around Southern California. At that time, this was the time where you had a band who should have taken over not just music, but also a huge portion of the culture. NWA. Band was more talented than people realize, more revolutionary than people realize. This was back when even BET was shying away from certain types of hip-hop. And at that time, a guy named Ice Cube was so upset with other members of NWA that he made a cut called No Vaseline. And he was naming names in that cut, criticizing other band members. This was back in a time where the DJ of that group, a guy most people didn't know, his name was Dr. Dre, got together with a rapper from Long Beach, who people didn't know, guy who called himself Snoop Dogg. And they were collaborating to help make a soundtrack for a movie that was not a blockbuster movie. And they put together a cut, and the cut was controversial. They couldn't even talk about the real theme for the cut. They had to use numbers. The rapper Snoop says it's 187 on an undercover cop. Let me just say, that soundtrack, the deep cover, that cut should be on the short list of the best cuts used in a soundtrack ever. Then, of course, they go on to do nothing but a G thing. Now, understand, back then, the music was so controversial that if you were driving around with the windows down, back then, guys used to drive big, older cars. Back then, a nice hardcore bass was not as common as it is now because it was harder to pull off. You were dealing with analog, not digital sound. Let's just say back then, if you were going through parts of the valley in Southern California, we're talking about Tarzana, we're talking about Reseda, and you were blasting that music and you were driving in a car that had a lot of bass and you were rolling through that part of the world, people looked at you. Understand, back then there wasn't all this internet and all this other stuff. This music wasn't being quite played on the radio. I believe Nothing But a G Thing was one of the first songs I know of where they actually cleaned up the lyrics in one of the versions to make it radio worthy. Well, to make a long story short, back in the early 1990s, I would cruise through Reseda, blasting hip-hop. Back then, they called it hip-hop. They also called it rap music and stuff like that. And L.A. was a bit divided. In other words, understand, you know, hip-hop was still outlaw music back then. Now it's corporate music, and now you're seeing hip-hop entrepreneurs owning parts of NBA teams. But back then, it was outlaw music. Back then, you know, names like Dr. Dre, Eazy-E, even Ice Cube, they were kind of more rumors than widespread truths, right? If you were in the community, you knew who these guys were. If you were out of the community, you really didn't. If you went to Santa Monica, if you went to Marina Del Rey, if you hung out in parts of the world there, you know, understand we weren't all playing the same music. The world was a lot more divided. There wasn't the net. You really didn't know what was happening across town until you hopped in your ride and you were out there. Now back then, in a more fractured world, Dan Goosen was hanging out with Mr. T. I'm not kidding. Guy from the A-Team. Those guys were boys. You would actually see them on TV together. And Dan Goosen was actually trying to make the Los Angeles boxing scene, right? He was a promoter. He had a venue, the Reseda Country Club. He had a superstar fighter, Michael Nunn, right? He was trying to develop the Ruelas brothers as fighters. He was literally trying to shine a light on the Los Angeles boxing scene. Let me say, it's a daunting task. I know there are a lot of local promoters who watch my videos. I know they're in places trying to keep the sport alive, trying to make the sport. But understand, Dan Goosen was that rare showman who was literally trying to do so in a big way. So back then, I remember watching Dan Goosen on TV pubbing Rafael Ruelas, pubbing Gabe Ruelas. Goosen had a brother who was a trainer, Joe Goosen, and both guys were talking up Michael Nunn. Michael Nunn was a great fighter, a truly great fighter. And understand, Goosen had major people skills. He was a big vision guy. I hadn't heard of him before I got to LA. For me, I thought boxing promoters back then were, you know, Bob Arum, Don King. You'd be surprised how long those guys have ruled the roost, right? It was Don King, Bob Arum. There were a few other names you heard about. Shelley Finkel, right? But Dan Goosen, literally, by force of personality and determination, right, tried to bring attention and glamour, right, to the sport at a time when it needed it, right? So I kept track of Dan Goosen, right? I was just a young kid out of school, hanging out, listening to NWA music and East Coast music, right? This was right before the big East Coast, West Coast feud, right? But let's just say, in the world of boxing, when I followed boxing, I remember thinking to myself, this Dan Goosen guy could take over boxing, right? This Dan Goosen guy was literally making the sport. Keep in mind, this is before Staples Center in Los Angeles, right? Back then, you did have the Fabulous Forum. You did have fights in the Fabulous Forum, but you understood there was a void, that you actually needed a guy in the area to kind of unite the community. And that's what Goosen tried to do, and he tried to do it in a funny and clever way, right? I remember I was watching a Goosen promotion on television, and they had Mr. T sitting next to Dan. And Mr. T was wearing cutlery. I'm not kidding. Things like knives and forks around his neck. And I remember they said to Mr. T, "Hey, Mr. T, what are you doing here?" And Mr. T's response was, "Well, I'm just trying to go from the ghetto to the get-mo." Right, and everyone laughed. That was the kind of atmosphere it was, right? And Dan Goosen always, even though he looked like he was in control of the situation, he always tried to look like he was just a face in the crowd watching an event. I always appreciated that persona. So years later, I met Dan Goosen, right? It was in a legal proceeding, but I was curious. You know, I had watched his career. I had seen the fighters he had promoted, right? I had, you know, let's say looked at some of the documents involved, and I saw that Dan Goosen was a guy with a big view, right? Understand, he was one of the guys behind Showtime's Super Six, right? He was a guy who understood the need for unity. He was a guy who, you know, really wanted to, how do I put it? You know, he really wanted to build the sport of boxing. And you could tell he was a bit of a Renaissance guy because he really wanted to bring people like Mr. T into boxing, right? Well, and celebrities, right? Goosen Events had celebrities at the event. So it was interesting because when I met him, he was a lot bigger in person than I thought he would be. And I was curious about the personality, right? Because I had heard he was larger than life. Now, you know what they say? Never meet your idols, right? Or never meet the people you admire, because sometimes they don't measure up. This is one of those rare cases where I met the guy, and the guy was even a bigger personality than I thought he would be. Right? He was with his brother. And it was interesting because I looked at the interaction between the two guys. Now keep in mind, you know, I'm there with a poker face. Right? You know, it could have been a monsoon outside and, you know, I would have looked disinterested. But as I looked across the table, I was a bit struck by just how close he and his brother were. Right? He had some other people there in the room with him. And I was curious about his interaction with these guys, and I was a bit struck by how he was clearly the leader of the pack. In other words, the guy had a certain natural leadership that just came through. In other words, you know, I could have walked in the room not knowing what Dan Goosen looked like, and I could have picked out Dan Goosen. That's the kind of guy he was. Bigger than life, friends who loved him dearly, big vision, committed to the sport of boxing, the kind of entrepreneur with the audacity to believe that he could help build boxing into something bigger in Los Angeles. And keep in mind, this is before, right, the emergence of Oscar De La Hoya, right? This is before the emergence of Staples, right? Just understand, Dan Goosen, in a sentence, visionary, bigger than life, audacious, committed, right? You know, you remember your first impression when you hear some news. When I heard that Dan Goosen had cancer, I was stunned. You know, the guy just looked to me to be, you know, someone who couldn't get cancer. You know, he just seemed larger than life. You know what I mean? The guy just seemed, you know, like things like that couldn't happen to me. I had to take a second after I heard the news to just let it hit me. And I remember one of my first thoughts was, wow, that's a big loss. Right? So Let me just say, I'm one of those who feels that boxing really did take a big loss here. Right? And, you can disagree with someone on certain issues, but you could still respect their vision, what they're trying to pull off. And I certainly had a lot of respect for Dan Goosen. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Thanks for stopping by.